is about simple diode circuits. Here we are going to concentrate on the half-wave rectifier part, where we will try to understand how half-wave rectifier helps in doing the AC to DC conversion, and we will also derive certain parameters that are related with half-wave rectifier circuits. A rectifier circuit generally uses a semiconductor PN junction diode, and the PN junction diode has a very low resistance in the forward direction and a very high resistance in the reverse direction. In all the analysis, the resistance in the reverse direction is assumed to be infinite most of the times, and here it conducts in the direction of the arrowhead. And to understand about the rectification process, a DC supply is needed for many applications like electroplating and for many other electronic circuits. A rectifier basically converts an AC voltage source to a DC signal, and it may be a single phase circuit or a polyphase circuit. So that we are not interested in as of now. When power requirement is low, basically a single phase rectifier is much sufficient, and only for high power requirements, polyphase rectifiers are more suitable. Now here we will concentrate on the half-wave rectifier circuit, where we will have one PN junction diode connected with the AC voltage source. Usually we assume here a transformer to be employed, where that transformer will automatically step down the AC supply voltage, and also it will prevent from shocks. The diode used here will help us in rectifying the AC signal into a pulsating DC, which will be taken or measured across this load resistor RL. This AC voltage source is basically a sinusoidal signal with a finite amount of frequency. So it will have both the positive half cycle and the negative half cycle. And during the positive half cycle, the diode D is going to be forward biased. As the diode is forward biased, the current flows through the load RL and a voltage is developed across it. During the negative half cycle, this diode is going to be reverse biased, and we understand that during the reverse biased condition, there is no flow of current through the RL, thereby the output voltage is going to be zero. So this we can observe from the simulation graphs, where I have taken the LTSpice output waveforms for the input voltage and for the output voltage across this resistance. This output clearly shows that the input signal is a completely sinusoidal, which has the positive half cycle and the negative half cycle, where the Vmax is 10 volt and it is varying up to minus Vm, which is minus 10 volt. But if you look at the Vout, the output voltage, that was developed across the resistance RL, you can see here that the diode, as it was conducting only during the forward bias, only for that time duration, the output is appearing. When the diode was reverse biased, you can see here that there was no voltage developed across the resistance RL. So therefore, here the output voltage is completely zero. So this is how the half-wave rectifier works to convert a sinusoidal or a varying AC voltage signal to a pulsating DC. It's not a constant DC voltage, it is a pulsating DC voltage signal. If the applied voltage is E equal to Em sin omega t to the half-wave rectifier, then this half-wave rectifier is going to conduct only during the forward bias, that is only for the first half, positive half of the cycle of the input signal. During the negative half cycle of the input signal, it does not conduct. So it is going to be Em sin omega t. Em is nothing but the peak voltage, the maximum voltage we have obtained here. It is going to be a sinusoidal signal, so it is sin omega t divided by, it is going to, because I am writing the current equation, so we need to write voltage divided by the resistance. The resistance is going to be total resistance, because here we have two resistors that are connected in series. What is that hidden resistor is? We had a diode in the forward direction, and when the diode conducts in the forward direction, we need to always assume the resistance of the diode also. So though it is negligible or not, that we can consider later. As of now, since the diode is in the forward direction, we need to consider the resistance of the diode in the forward direction as capital RF plus RL, the load resistor. So now EM by RF plus RL. So this part, which is similar to V by R, can be written as IM. So I will be equal to IM sine omega t when it varies from 0 to pi. And when it is going to vary from pi to 2 pi, it is going to be 0 because the diode does not conduct in the reverse bias. Now to estimate the DC components of the current, which are the average value of I over one full cycle, which means 0 to 2 pi is the one complete cycle. So now let us identify what is IDC, DC value of the current, which is over one complete cycle, which is 1 by 2 pi, and integral 0 to 2 pi, which is I into d of omega t, because it is varying with respect to omega t. Now we know what is I, the instantaneous variation of the current, which was IM into sine of omega t into d of omega t. So this we know that we had this condition only over 0 to pi. So this will be changed as 0 to pi IM sine of omega t d of omega t plus from pi to 2 pi, this IM sine omega t was not there. Instead, we had 0. So it will be d of omega t, 0 and 2. So this we need to solve now. After integrating IM sine omega t with respect to omega t over the interval 0 to pi, we can get minus of cos omega t with the integral limits as 0 to pi. So once you substitute all those things, the values for cos pi and cos 0, and then we'll be getting IM by pi when we know that IM is equal to EM by RF plus RL. So therefore IDC, the average value of I over one complete cycle, is going to be EM by pi into RF plus RL. Next, we need to find out the RMS, the root mean square, or the effective value of the current. So that will be square root of 1 by 2 pi integral 0 to 2 pi I square of d of omega t. So again, we will take this integral part alone separately, and then we will bring it inside the square root. Once we do the integral for IM sine omega t the whole square, here I've given the general equation for integral of sine square x dx, which is x by 2 minus sine 2 x by 4. Here if we directly substitute, because IM square is going to be a constant, so I've taken it out. So if we directly substitute the upper limit pi, then we'll be getting it as pi by 2 minus sine 2 pi by 4. And if we are going to substitute 0 in case of x, that's not going to give us any value. So I've just substituted pi here. And even in this, no, sine 2 pi is going to be again 0. So therefore, we'll be getting only pi by 2 im square. So now here, once you substitute this pi by 2 im square in square, the square root, then we'll be having im by 2. Because all these pi pi gets cancelled, im square by 4 will be there. Out of square root, you'll be having IM by 2. And we know what is IM. IM is equal to EM by RF plus RL. So this is going to be your final RMS, or the effective value of current. As we know that the voltage across the load resistance RL is going to be I into RL, then we can easily write down the peak voltage, the average voltage or the DC voltage, and the RMS voltage, because we have it in our hand, the peak current IM, DC current IDC we have, and then the RMS current also we have. Multiply all the values with respect to RL, that gives us the corresponding peak voltage, DC voltage, and the RMS voltage. This DC voltage, which is EM RL by pi into RF plus RL, can be rewritten as follows. Like, I am going to take this one EM by pi out, and I'm going to insert it in terms of IDC. So once you substitute the formula for IDC, you can actually get the same EM RL by pi into RF plus RL. Okay, so now what we need to understand is, see, I've written this equation to understand two main things. One is, we need to observe what is the DC output voltage when there is no load and when there is load that is connected. So at no load conditions, the DC output voltage BDC will be EM by pi because there is no load. So therefore, your DC current, IDC, will become zero. So therefore, VDC will be only EM by pi. At load conditions, the VDC decreases linearly with IDC. So this is actually during load condition. So during no load, the IDC becomes zero. And also we should understand that the regulation will become poor when RF is a amount of considerable amount of resistance. So in such a case, what we are trying to interpret here is when RF is small, the regulation is going to be good. But if RF is a considerable amount of resistance, then the DC regulation is going to be little poor. So now we will see what is the DC power that is delivered to the load, which can be written as I square DC into RL, because power usually we write it as I square R. So this IDC we know, which is EM by pi into RF plus RL. So substituting that here, this equation will become EM square RL by pi square into RF plus RL the whole square. Now similarly, the total power input to the circuit PN can be written as I square into RF plus RL. Because when you look the circuit from the input side, you actually have two resistance. When the diode is in forward bias, you have one resistance that is associated with this RF, and there is one more load resistance. So therefore, we need to write the total power input to the circuit as I square into RF plus RL. And we know what is I. I is the RMS or the effective value of the current, which is EM by 2 into RF plus RL. So therefore, one RF plus RL will get cancelled, and therefore we will be having. So this is the total power input to the circuit. Now when we take the ratio of DC power delivered to the load to the total power input to the circuit, then we are going to obtain the rectifier efficiency. So finally, the rectifier efficiency is calculated here by taking the ratios of DC power delivered to the load and the total power input to the circuit. After cancelling out the common terms, we have 2 by pi the whole square into RL by RF plus RL. So once we find out 4 by pi square the value, it will be 0.406, and we have just slightly remodified this RL by RF plus RL as 1 plus RF by RL. When the forward resistance of the diode is going to be very less when compared to the load resistance, then this term becomes completely negligible because of the low forward resistance of the diode when compared to the load resistance. So therefore, the eta, the rectifier efficiency, reaches its theoretical maximum value of 40.6%. Finally, to estimate the ripple factor of the half-wave rectifier circuit, we need to first calculate the ratio of RMS value of the current to the DC current, which will give us pi by 2. And therefore, the ripple factor can be written as square root of I by IDC the whole square minus 1. Now we have I by IDC. Just substitute that. That will give us pi by 2 the whole square minus 1. And then we need to take a square root. Therefore, this will give us gamma equal to 1.21, which is the ripple factor for the half-wave rectifier circuit. Hope the complete video on the half-wave rectifier circuit was useful. And we have also seen different parameters that are associated with the half-wave rectifier circuit, starting from the maximum current, the input voltage, and then the DC current, or the average value of I over one full cycle. And then we have also seen the RMS or the effective value of the current. And along with this, we have seen parallelly what is the peak voltage, average voltage, and the RMS voltage. And we have also seen one important feature of the DC output voltage, because the DC output voltage is not going to be constant because it depends on the load resistance. Therefore, during no load condition also, we have understood what will be the DC output voltage, and then slowly we have migrated to the power calculation, where we have identified the DC power and the total input power. Dividing both of that will give us the rectifier efficiency, and finally we have ended up a discussion of half-wave rectifier circuit with ripple factor calculation. So in the next video, we will solve problems that are related to the half-wave rectifier. Until then, stay tuned. Thanks for watching this video through Electronics Insight channel.